Hello, welcome to today's edition of the Citizens Church TV. I am Phillip Muliisa. Today, the church is interrogating Uganda's search for a peaceful transition since independence, and we're paying key interest to the things we've done long in this journey, very long journey. Helping us in that discussion is a panel of distinguished citizens of this country, Uganda, who have seen all, almost, of what has happened in the country, and I will introduce them. Starting from my extreme left is from the NRM, the Director of External Affairs, retired Major Awich Pollar. Major, you must welcome to the show.
Thank you. Greetings to our viewers.
Thank you. Next to the Major is from the Uganda People's Congress, the Honorable Ochieno Joseph. Honorable Joseph, you must welcome to the show.
Thank you for having me. You do a fantastic job.
Thank you so much. And the only lady on the show, from Electoral Rules and Governance, Council Charity Ahimbisibwe. Council, you must welcome to the show.
Thank you very much, Phil, and very good afternoon to all those who are viewing us. Good afternoon to the panelists.
Thank you so much. And last but not least is Dr. Robert, Ojambo, the head of the Faculty of History and Political Science, Kyambogo University. Dr. Imoso,
Department.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. Good evening, viewers. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you. And I'll start with you, Doctor, with a very direct question that feeds directly to the topic. Uganda's search for a peaceful transition since independence. What have we done wrong? What are we doing wrong?
Yeah, thank you very much. Maybe we just first have to understand what is this country called Uganda. Uganda was a poor pronunciation of Uganda by the British, say so. And the interest of the British was so much developed at the source of the Nile, which was very important for their survival in Egypt and Sudan. So when they found, according to them, that the source of the Nile was around that area, they had to open up relationships with the leadership that was surrounding it. And at that time, the kingdom that was near there was the Uganda Kingdom during Mutesa. Just a one's time. And for that matter, they imagined that the whole area around this area was called Uganda. And they used to speak Swahili because most of them learned Swahili. So they started calling this area Uganda. That's why there is a difficulty in understanding whether it was Uganda or Uganda agreement. But when you dig carefully, it was a Uganda agreement that later forced. And it's on that basis that in 1894, this country or this area was declared a British protectorate. And they went on adding on until 1926. That's when we had a country that we call today Uganda. And of course, that went on up to 1962. When we got independence and started governing us ourselves. Now, that independence, if it was in athletics, it was on a false start. Because there were so many things. The constitution was discussed in Lancaster, and they were discussing a constitution with communities. Each community in Uganda sent a delegate to the Lancaster conference. But Uganda, which had been a very good friend of the British, was very, very cagey in that discussion. And for that matter, one of our great writers called Kurt Bitek was at that time in London. And somebody asked him to describe the situation in which the constitution was being discussed in Lancaster conference. And the old man, then a young man, said that it was like a sack of eggs. It was like a sack of eggs. You know, you can just imagine you are carrying eggs in a sack. You have to be very careful. You have to be very careful on how you treat Buganda specifically. And of course, Buganda later, at first I forgot it, Buganda didn't even want to send delegates there. They wanted to go as a government. And that's why you see, even when it comes to independence, they declared the independence a day earlier. So Buganda became an issue in Uganda. Of course, with the other communities, now there are two major issues that later fails the Lancaster Conference to discuss. I want to give you a historical perspective so that you understand what is happening. So in that conference, there were two thorny issues. The issue of Uganda within Uganda. Uganda within Uganda. And then the issue of lost counties in Bunyoro Kingdom, which had been taken over by the British and parts of it given to the Uganda establishment. So the British failed to resolve that matter. And the third issue was the issue of the leader, who would be the leader of Uganda. And therefore they said that these issues would be discussed later. So Uganda was given independence with all three problems. The problem of Uganda, the problem of the lost counties, and the problem of who would lead Uganda as a whole. So we get independence, of course, first 1 year when we were discussing the independence constitution, we had a government of the DP, which ruled only for 1 year, with the chief minister. That's what he was called, Victor Kiwanuka. But in 1962, we now get the prime minister, who was an executive head. In 1963, they resolved the issue of the leadership, and they say we shall have a president. And that's how they reached the idea of a president coming from, because of the issue of Uganda, still, because UPC at that time did not have clear majority. It looked fair way to deal with Kabaka Yeka, which was a Uganda establishment. So that's how Kabaka Mutesa II becomes the first president, who purportedly was elected among the people like Nadiope later complained and said they had not been involved. But of course, Nadiope was made vice president. And the life started. Then, in 1964, the idea of the lost counties came. And the debate began. So the president was in a catch-22. Does he support Uganda or he supports Uganda? You know, he's the president of Uganda and a Kabaka. So he started a project called the Daiga Project, and was ferrying people from Uganda here to take them to areas of Bunyoro, because he knew that in 1964 there was supposed to be a vote. So in 1964, irrespective of what he did, he does not succeed. Most of the people in the lost countries voted to be in Bunyoro. And that sparked a conflict between Kabaka Yeka and UPC, leading us to the 1966 crisis. So that is where the issue of transition starts to get a problem. Because remember, there was supposed to be an election a year later, in 1967. Now there is a crisis, which is sometimes called Kabaka crisis, sometimes Uganda crisis. Sometimes some scholars even call it Uganda crisis, because it later affected the whole country. And that's when the king is deposed, and so many things. And then Uganda now becomes a republican in 1967 with the Republican Constitution of 1967. So that's what I want to start from. Election have not taken place. There is a big quarrel between Uganda and the central government, and now this is worsened. So the things you see, the accusation of Idi Amin and the other people in the gold scandal, were out of this crisis. People trying to position themselves and fight within this. And at the end of the day, we had 1971 coup, and that coup became a landmark in Uganda's politics. So much so that since 1971, we have never believed that somebody can come to power without a military coup. And this was it was emulated in 1986 by Yoweri Museveni. In fact, when you read Yoweri Museveni's thing, he always went for election just for the sake of it.
So the 1971 coup brings an idea in Uganda that you cannot change government without using the gun. And that is emulated in 1986 by Yoweri Museveni, because in 1980, there was an election where Yoweri Museveni won only one seat, and that one was of Crispus Kiyonga. So then they were counting the number of seats that you would win to form a government. So that really showed that the man would not win an election. But he says that the election was bad, there was a lot of things, so people go to the bush, and in 1986 he becomes the president. Since then, there have been elections, but elections only organized from 70 to win. Yeah. So because of that, you can never have... So we have been having transition from 71 to 72 to 73 to 74, now 77.
And soon, 70 the sun.
Thank you so much, Dr. Robert, for that comprehensive historical perspective of transition and the country Uganda. I want to come to Council Charity here. You see, the good doctor tells us the history and the idea of leadership cannot change in Uganda without the use of a gun. Before we get there, legally speaking, what should a transition look like in this country called Uganda?
The Constitution actually says we change power through elections and does provide, therefore, for the Electoral Commission, and it also provides for Article 59 that allows for a citizen who is 18 years and above to participate in elections. Now, the Constitution also provides for when the president dies, what happens? How do we go by such a circumstance? Who takes over and for how long? Remember the state of emergency which we discussed during the time of COVID-19? That all emanates out of if there is no head of state. So the Speaker of Parliament takes over, and during that time of takeover, there should be a state of emergency that has been declared, and within 6 month period, an election is then prepared and conducted. But there is a second avenue that the Constitution also provides, and that is the one of the Vice President taking over and fulfills the term. We saw it happening in Tanzania when the President of Tanzania died. Samia Suluhu took over and completed the term of the President, and it is hoped that at the end of that term, then an election will be conducted. And that then brings me to the good question you're asking. Then where is this transition coming from? In Article 3 of our Constitution, about two or three things are envisaged. Article 3 envisages a situation of a coup. Should a coup take place, what happens to the 1995 Constitution? Because we had seen, like from the historical perspective you've had, there was a 1962 constitution that was abrogated along the way. My friend didn't want me to use this word, but it's the one we're told in class that Obote abrogated the constitution. Because when Joseph comes, he will hit it hard on the head. Mm-hmm. But that is what we have. And I've challenged him over and over that the books write the word abrogation. So we get that 1967 Republican Constitution. But remember, we have a 67 Republican Constitution that is coming on the heels of a pigeonhole Constitution. Now, that whole fallacy of uncertainty, which Doctor was talking about here, is the question, or we are trying to answer a political question, and the question of democracy, okay? We're trying to answer a political question and a question of democracy. And Article 3, which I was alluding to, talks of citizens defending the Constitution no matter what. that if anybody wants to change any clause in that constitution, citizens should defend it and no one should touch it. But have we seen that constitution amended while citizens were defending it? Yes, we've seen that constitution amended while citizens were defending it. What happened? They went ahead and still amended the constitution. Now, that article also says that any citizen who is found defending the constitution, even if you fight, throw stones, as long as you're defending the constitution, you commit no crime.
True.
But is it true that while we shouted and said, "Toji kwatako," we committed no crime, or there were people who were locked up? There were people who were locked up for doing "Toji kwatako" and for even going to Mbale while the current Chief Justice, Owinyi Dollo, was seated in court and deciding on the issue of 102B. The people who were saying, "No, don't touch the constitution," were branded as political activists who didn't wish the country well. But if you look at the broad issue of Article 3, actually the people who were defending, the people who were opposed to the removal of Article 102B of the constitution, were the real heroes of Uganda, according to the constitution. So then we talk of that question of transition. So the constitution is not explicit on you're going to change government through a transition. No. The constitution is explicit with the question of elections. That is the known format for political change in Uganda. Now, Nomad Mao has started a discussion where he tells us, if we do not pay attention to the tension and anger and the things around Uganda, and we don't talk about peaceful transfer of power, then we have a crisis. And yes, civil society has been calling for transition, because if you read the preamble of our constitution, we talk about the period he was talking about. We talk about the 1966 crisis. Then from there, we talk about the Amin government and all the killings that happened there. And then after the Amin government, we talk about the 1986 war. And after the 86 war, then comes the NRM government trying to settle us down for 40 years. And now the question is, do we want to go back to the tumultuous period that we know happened before 1986? And I want to posit that Ugandans are not interested in war. As a people, they're not interested in war. Why do I say that? They even see the war in Palestine, and they want to think of it as a very distant thing. When Kizza Besigye was here campaigning all the time, he campaigned, he said, we shall not go back to the bush. You know why? Because he knows there is no one he's going to convince to go to the bush. Who is it that can start a war in Uganda? It can only be the UPDF. But who is within that UPDF to start a war right now? You also think about it logically. So if you're going to call us to a transition, that we transfer power peacefully, and because if we don't transfer this power peacefully, we don't know what would happen, because this is all trying to answer the question of uncertainty.
Thank you so much, Council, for that submission. Honorable Chen, I want to come to you. The UPC has been in power twice in this country called Uganda, or the poor pronunciation of Uganda, like Professor here say.
Obote always called it Uganda, so it's very right. Yeah.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. What kind of political future did the UPC envision for the country called Uganda?
The best. The best, and the best that we attempted to found. It is clearly the case that when I look back, I was on some related conversations yesterday on some media networks, and I actually told this country that we told you so. We warned you guys at the beginning of independence, and you thought we were being selfish. We warned you at the peak of the conflicts and the contradictions that Robert refers to, and people thought we were being, it was about us. We warned you when Amin came, you know, and you thought it was about the other. We warned you when these bandits went to the bush, and you thought it was this thing about these Mucholis, these northerners. We warned you when Museveni entrenched himself, and thought it was all about UPC. Today, here we are. the transition seems to be now modeled around a pressure group that our land friends here might have to tell us whether or not they're a pressure group, a political organization, and which special pressure group has got more power than an average civil society organization. That actually cheekily, when they organize in Kampala, instructions are for local government leaders from across the country to come into Kampala. I don't want to know who pays for their transportation to Kampala. I don't want to know who runs the offices when they're absent. I don't know, therefore, when they leave the offices, whether it's in Tungamo or in Iganga, and they're coming for a meeting about a pressure group in Kampala. They take annual leave. They take time off in lieu. Or who gives them authority to leave? I ask that question. So that's the mess in which we are. But look, part of this conversation as it continues, I still find it extremely disingenuous, and I still find UPC not getting sufficient credit that it does. And today, I think I want to use this to also not lay accusing hands, but to say, since I'm around a senior a lecturer here and head of department, that perhaps the underlying other alternatives around the instabilities around Uganda are not looked at enough. And I'm glad Dr. Ojambo sort of hit on it directly. That's the question of the conflicting, and I like the way you founded it, actually, this question about Uganda and Buganda, and Buganda at the heart of this. I think it's almost normally presented as uncool to point accusing fingers at anything except Obote and UPC, in this case, particularly on Buganda. And I think it's an intellectual laziness. And I think also that the missing links will normally be the external forces as interests in the instabilities of our political country, of our political country. But anyway, I take you back. At independence, basically, to be precise about your question, by independence, UPC, primarily as the largest political party and the most influential political party at the time, were very clear about the country that we needed. When I look back through history and actually the arguments that DP was making, DP was also actually quite rather nice about the Uganda that would try to seek to govern at independence. So I'm not quite sure whether it was necessarily about lack of ideas in terms of where we're going. It was primarily around the conflicting interests that then existed, and that is whether or not we had a nation state called the Republic of Uganda, for whom we needed independence, or there was a Uganda within Buganda. I must say this, though, that going to Lancaster House, Robert, I'm not quite sure whether, because the fact that we're actually a colony, I'm not necessarily particularly bothered that we went to London. You know, the issue is whether or not we had a reasonable representation to London. And I think the representation to London was, if you like, in my opinion, much more legitimate than the makers of the 1995 Constitution. And I know we've had this conversation here, where I believe that the 1995 Constitution, although the Ugandans were mobilized and, you know, political parties had hands tied. So in other words, if you find key political players in matters like this, you know, in prison, then anything that comes out of that, in my opinion, should be illegitimate. So
thank you.
The foundation in terms of our republic was well-meaning, and there was reasonable consensus. I must say that since the third point that, Robert, just for clarification, I think the third element beyond the lost counties was really primarily fresh elections rather than leadership. The leadership thing was actually an outcome of internal politics, whether or not we should continue with the British Governor General as our overall head of state. So that was an internal political question in Uganda. And it's true also that UPC pushed for Sir Edward to be the first, you know, elected titular leader of our country. And Nadiope would only have cried foul because indeed he was a UPC candidate and he stood for the same position because he wanted it. So basically, barely crying foul. But no, it was a formal and normal democratic process, except that Nadiope was backed by DP because DP did not support Sir Edward. But at Lancaster, the issue was, while all the other issues were, that the election that took place in 1961 was seen to be not representative because in Buganda, Buganda did not participate in the elections. And UPC managed to unlock, you know, the electorate in Buganda by compelling Buganda to allow the process to do take place. So founding at that stage, I think I can make the contribution next time. I know you want to go to the next
Thank
part
you so much.
But at the foundation, I think we are on okay.
Thank you so much. Major Witch, you who is in the NRM, the NRM and President Museveni has been in power for the past 38 years and still counting. And looking across through the continent, we have very many leaders that have been in power for very long. And if I give two or three examples, Field Marshal Omar el-Bashir in Sudan, very many years, and how he ended. You had Blaise Compaoré in Burkina Faso, and how he ended. Then we also had Mwalimu Julius Nyerere in Tanzania, and how he ended. But also Daniel Arap Moi in Kenya, and how he finished. These are four examples, but different endings. How does the NRM look at their ending? Is it the Bashir way or the Nyerere way?
Bashir.
NRM ending is a very democratic one. I can assure you. I will explain how. As I prepare to summarize and answer your question, I just like to make a few remarks in relation to what my colleagues have said. Indeed, like Doctor says, in the current constitution, there is an implied cutoff for Uganda, and that is when it asks for who is a Ugandan. That a Ugandan is somebody whose parents or grandparents was a member of indigenous community in Uganda, and it is there attached to Schedule 3,
yes.
Third Schedule, and it indicates indigenous community actually alphabetically listed. Incidentally, Banyarwanda, one of them.
Why incidentally?
Because many people, incidentally, because if you go across Uganda, you also have a country called Rwanda. So we confuse the Banyarwanda from Rwanda to the Banyarwanda who are Ugandans. That is why I say incidentally. It's like if you have a tribe in Uganda called Sudanese, and then there's a country called Sudan.
So that's the unique tribe.
It is unique, yeah, but it's there. But for clarity, these are part of the Rwandese who are cut by colonial boundaries because the Bafumbira during the CA making, they chose to identify with the Mount Mufumbira and they called themselves Bafumbira. But the Ruzindana, the Gadga, Satura in Ntungam said, we don't have a river here and we are not Banyankole. So who are we? So we shall maintain our identity as Banyarwanda. It is there in the constitution. So that cutoff of February 1926 cuts off, meaning that that is really the minimum time that Uganda took shape. And this is recognition because the various parts like Kisoro, which was in Rwanda, brought to Uganda, West Nile, which was in Congo, and then the other part, which was lost to Kenya. So the current map is presumed by implication to have taken shape there. And therefore, that is what we are. Now, I want to draw attention to the fact that the issue that we are discussing about, many brains, including the Professor Kanyamba, addressed it in the CA. The Constituent Assembly took place in a conference center, Serena, and it was heavily addressed and discussed and put in the Constitution. So I do not see any cause of worry. I also like to say that we should take cognition of the fact that Uganda has had one peaceful transfer of power, at least. That is the UNLF government, where there was a military commission government. A military commission government which had three presidents, shared presidency. There was a trinity of presidents of Justice Nyamuchoncho, Justice Musoke, and Mr. Wacholwol. It was a trinity that was sworn as head of state, and they led the country for 6 months. They're the ones who conducted the election of 1980 and handed over to Obote to peacefully. So we could give credit to Uganda for a peaceful transfer of power. And at this point, I'm not even sure whether those who are talking about transition take transfer of power to be synonymous to transition. I find myself the use of transition, even an alien term. I don't know what they mean. But if we mean transfer of power, there was a government of a president, a shared presidency, which transferred, handed over power to Obote. They were the presidents. They were the ones pardoning people for if you're condemned to death. They are the ones giving presidential pardon if they release you from prison. They are the ones signing on the Act of Parliament, NCC, National Consultative Council, because a law cannot become a law until it is assented to by the president. They were the ones who did it. And there are many laws they did to that effect. It's in the statute book. So these were presidents. So we can credit Uganda for that. Now, NRM says to power is that indeed, according to some constitutional theory, if you grab power and you become legitimate, you become government. In the views of NRM revolutionary, it was called for that the total state machinery needed to be dismantled, and people preferred to do a revolutionary way and took over power, and the rest is history. Briefly about rigging elections, somebody mentioned that NRM Museven goes for election for the sake of election. I don't think that is true, because if we wanted to rig election, we wouldn't let our cadres suffer. How would we choose to rig in other parts of the country except central region where NUP was? How would we have chosen to sacrifice our vice president with all the shame that your vice president is losing election? So this election, if somebody else wins, there is democracy. If NRM wins, it is rigging. I think we better be honest about it. If we were rigging elections, we wouldn't have had the wave that sweeps in that area. Why do we choose to rig in other areas and not rig here? That is not true. Then this brings me to the topic, transition. I am not so sure whether my friends who are developing this thinking, I don't even know who brings the coinage, a transition, from who to who. I don't know whether they mean a transition means a transfer of power. Transition in ordinary grammatical sense is a move from one state to another, a flow. But then, if this is a transition that they're talking of, who should complain about transition or peaceful transfer of power? It is actually should be NRM crying for a peaceful transition. You know why? Once the status quo is in your hand, it is others who want to remove it by force from you. So the status quo is in our hands. It is us actually who should be telling people, ladies and gentlemen, please, peaceful transfer. Now they seem to be telling us. Even in a land, if you have a land matter and the court finds you in occupation, you are the one in status quo is in your favor. Isn't the one outside the land who should talk when you are the one digging? So it is us who should actually be telling people. For example, when Besigye and others have tended to mobilize with the intention or implication to a riot, to what you call insurrection, so that people should rise up, go to state house and take over power. That would be the non-transition. And who would be the victim or who would be the loser? It is us in power who would lose. So I'm really wondering why some people are crying more than they believed. It is the status quo holder who should actually develop ideological, spiritual means to cool people. For example, it is the one in power who should be saying, even going to churches to tell churches, tell people, please, we want peaceful transfer. In other words, let us be in power. It should be us going to the market and say, please. So this debate is skewered. For us, we know that the Constitution provides for everything. And that's why I started with CA. Everything is catered for. We are debating something which is non-existent. But about the non-peaceful transfer, it should be us crying. Please don't bring insurrection. Please don't overthrow us by force. Please don't go to the bush. Please don't do this. It should be us crying.
In the
now, why, who is crying more than us?
Major. In the National Resistance Movement,
yes,
there is a group of people, including members of parliament, who say they should be allowed to contest in the primaries to get that card of presidency, and they are not allowed.
No, who says they're not allowed? Those ones are talking their own things. I sit at the secretariat. I know the constitution of the party like my fingertips. The constitution allows, unless they're not, they don't know the procedure. The procedure is candidates show their interest and they are vetted by SEC. Then SEC sends the candidature to national conference. So now, if that person is aggrieved, then let him start by amending that provision. Let him start by amending. But if he's a party member who was voted to be a party member, then he should respect it. But we can have other flag bearers in Namboli because it's a national conference which picks a flag bearer. So therefore, this idea of tagging it like to NRM, which does not want a peaceful transition, or which does not want transition, it is us, the status quo holders, who are actually praying for a peaceful ending, because we don't want you to mobilize on the street and raise the insurrection, because we don't want to go to the bush and overthrow us by force, because we... So who is the loser? The status quo holder or the non-status quo holder? We want peaceful transition, and the CA has catered for that, both within the party and at the national level. For the country, CA has catered for it. Look at the constitution. And she has explained, we have a similar provision like Tanzania. For our party, we have a constitution. It is catered for. So who is crying about us being thrown out without a peaceful transition? It should be us, the status holder, who is telling you, please don't go to the bush. Please don't go through insurrection. Please let us be in power. Then we go in peace. But the debate is the other way around.
Thank you, Major. Thank you, indeed, the victim of peaceful transition and what would happen thereafter. Dr. Ojambo, you see, the good Major keeps making it sound so sweet for the NRM to be in power and how they should not lose it and how they are the victims. But what we talk about is someone getting out of presidency and another one comes in. It doesn't matter whether it's in the same political party. It has not happened.
So I think, my friend, let's, for this debate, let's just give our working definition of transition.
Mm-hmm. That's what I
asked. That's what we want to do here.
I don't know where the coin is coming from.
We give a working definition to settle his complaint. Our working definition of transition is a transfer of power from the existing leader to another leader.
We don't care.
Yes, it will be transferred by nature. Fine. By fine. Nature. There, that fine. One is by nature.
Fine.
But you know, his argument and the high tone really explains what I've been telling people, that national resistance movement is not what it tells people that it is. National resistance movement is a colonial party. Just like the British and the French and the other people came and colonized the countries in Africa, NRM just thinks like that. They are like the British, the French who colonized the Burkina Faso, which you talked about. And you can hear that from his, that you see they are the ones. They don't imagine that they are just players who are playing with other people, or even if it is put in the constitution. And that's why the other constitution, which was amended, was even better, because that one was clear. It was saying, I am here, other political parties, go away. That was better. In fact, they amended that in 2005, but the amendment was remained on paper. So they think that they are the ones. And that thinking, even the transition, if you have been leading the transitional debate, and the main leader of the transition, I will not mention his name, he says us, the Machuezi, who are ruling over Rwanda, he associates it up to Ethiopia. And you look at a mind of a colonialist. Major, Uganda is not a colony. Uganda is a country. This country is made up of many players. We have a party in power, NRM. But the party in power, according to our constitution, is supposed to compete with other parties. And they are supposed to be listened to. So if you are saying that, who are they to say something Even in the NRM itself, there are people who are of that view, who are talking about transition. So I don't think that attitude is poor, and it's a poor attitude. And for me, I look at that from the mind of Yoweri Museveni, and these are his disciples. Majors are his disciples. Yoweri Museveni, from the time when he was in Dar es Salaam University, I interrogated one of his classmates who was my supervisor. And he gave me the mind of this young man they were with at the university and what he used to say. He wanted power, but not power to come and serve the people of Uganda, but to exalt power like a king would do, like a colonialist would do. And that's why when he was one time in this district next to Hoima is what? The bigger one.
Masindi.
He voters asked him and he said, I'm not your servant. I am here to work for my people. Himself, I had him on TV. So this one is not something I could imagine. And this is the problem. She talked about the constitution. I've had issues with the constitution and the constitution making process. I've written a whole paper on it as the constitution as the tool for dictatorship in Uganda. That constitution was tailor-made. The delegates in the Constituent Assembly were there, but many of them, 70%, did not know why they were there. There was a commission of 10, and one time I had problems with the Matembe. She almost had issues with me because she was one of the commissioners.
Yes,
she was one of the commissioners.
Even Kanyehamba
was one of the commissioners. Now, there were articles in the constitution that were supposed to be entrenched.
Mm.
She was complaining about articles which were changed on age, on terms. Those articles were supposed to be entrenched. And at the beginning, they were entrenched articles. But Museveni called the commissioners and convinced them. He said, no, there is going to be an election, free and fair. Why do you entrench those things? Because if they entrenched them, they would need a referendum. But for me, they would have been entrenched more than even a referendum. But they did not. Look at the powers of the president. But because this transition is affected by the presidency. In Uganda, the presidency is so powerful. The power of the presidency in the constitution is a misnomer. The presidency has 46, 47 articles that give him ultimate power to appoint, to decree, to do a lot of things that give him a lot of power. The president in Uganda has only failed. He cannot appoint a bishop or these other guys, witch doctors, the leaders of the witch doctors. But he appoints anybody in Uganda who has power, who controls power, points the IGP, points the CDF, points ministers, points judges, appoints. So he appoints almost everybody. Even recently, our poor cows, chief administrative officers, who are being appointed by public service, are now also under him. They amended the constitution. Now he has a say. So that gives him a lot of power. So a president determines a lot of things. This man even appoints the chairperson of the Electoral Commission. Look at the Constitution of Kenya, 210 Constitution. It has somehow removed some power. That's why you see Uhuru was a president, but there are certain things he would not do because he did not have power on who is the chairman of the Electoral Commission. I was seeing Uhuru crying foul against the chairman of the Electoral Commission, and I was saying, hey, did he get coaching from his friend here? Look at the judges. In fact, the president, when I was at the university, the first complaint he had, he said that the police was very bad, and he would chase them away. He said, policemen, go away. You are bad people. You don't like NRM. During the time of Odomel, and the last police leader we had was Kisembo. In my view, the last police leader that we had who was a policeman was Kisembo. And that was the time when he was, today, to be a police officer, you have to be a cadre. You a cadre. So at the end of the day, you find my friend Ochora is there. Sometimes students mock me in class when I say IGP Ochora. They say, but that one, is he still there? So you have a police leader, but there are people who are surrounding him, who are men, who take decision, and many other things. So at the end of the day, this transition you are talking about is so much affected by the constitution that we have. The constitution is it is the guide of the dictator. And when they succeed in something, they say, according to the constitution. They say, but doesn't the constitution say so? In fact, he will mock you. That you see, this constitution has been amended with the support of the people. But how? You can't amend a constitution. Whenever we are going for an election, Yoweri Museveni, in fact, me, I feel to say that sometimes Yoweri Museveni really performs badly. Because by the time you go for election, he has 2 million people who are working for him, RDCs, I don't know which one, I don't know, who cannot allow, he has him. He cannot allow government to collapse. So he starts with the 2 million people who are supporting him because their survival depends on him because of the powers that he has. So when you go for an election, you are only helping him to reach where he's going. Nobert Mao, when he was still discussing things, he used to call it swimming, unfair swimming contestation, where the one swimmer is in a swimming costume and the others are in an overall with gumboots. And when they fall in the water, they drown immediately and the other one swims over. So this, I want us now to move to the current issues. Let's leave the history and these other things. The current issues on transition are really complicated. So we are going to have a transition. Transition we must. Mm-hmm. We are going to have a transition. You who doesn't want transition, it is going to be there. The only question we should ask ourselves, transition to who? So, category one, we may have a transition from 70 to 70. That is category one. If we go in for an election and things are the way they are, they are very high likely, there is a high likelihood that we are going to have a transition from 70 to 70. The only difference will be that the older 70 will leave and the younger 70 will come. Two, there is also a possibility, and this one you should not rule out, people don't want it. We may have a transition by the military. That is the other likelihood I can see. We are going to have a transition where we are coming from military man, Yoweri Museveni, to another military man through military means. But transition by Ugandans, I don't see it. Because the candidate who is coming into play, in my view, is not popular. And therefore, he can only be assisted by Museveni to go through.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Council, you see, Doctor here talks about the Constitution and the challenges it has. I want you to talk to the status of the Constitution, the way you see it, but also given the power of the presidency he talked about, do we have means legally where we can address some and reduce some of these powers of the presidency?
Yes, you were supposed to undertake a constitutional review process after 10 years. It has never happened up to now. That constitutional review process and the reforms that you hear people talking about is a whole process that would give you a chance to review your own constitution and see where are the powers concentrated, how do we reduce them, and why are we reducing them. And I've listened very keenly to the doctor and also to Paula Awich on the question of transition. And the doctor ends by positioning the fact that we shall transit. Whether we want it or not, we must transit. There will come a date when we are transitioning, when there will be transfer of power, whether peacefully or non-peacefully. And it is true that in a political dispensation like that of Uganda, we've tested both. He said we transferred power by election in 1996, in 2001. Up to now, we've been doing elections. That was transiting. We were transferring power. Sure. Because he has said, in the context in which we're discussing, transition, therefore, is the transfer of power, peaceful transfer of power from one person to the next. So for us, we have transferred power from one person to the same person from 1996 up to now. And in the previous time, we transferred power by the gun. Power was only transferred by the gun. And he says there will be a military man. There is a possibility of a military man. And it is true. And this is what Norbert Mao was saying. Norbert Mao called us to reflect a bit deeper on the future of Uganda. And he was saying our institutions are now weak. Okay? So the doctor is saying power being concentrated in one person has led to a number of problems, deficits. And the deficits we see now is that parliament cannot function to the level it is supposed to function. The judiciary cannot function to the level to which it is supposed to function. Recently, the Uganda Law Society was banned from discussing a letter where the president had written to the Chief Justice and asking him to take action. And Uganda Law Society said, so where does this leave the independence of the judiciary? And this is what they wanted to talk about. They just wanted to talk about the independence of an institution called the judiciary. And so why is it important to talk who is it, AG? Yes, he banned the discussion. The court wrote and said there is no lawyer who is going to discuss anything to do with that letter. Now, if the court writes, anybody in the legal system knows the highest point of power is the Supreme Court. So if the court writes and tells you, an officer of the court, that you cannot discuss, the court has dictated, shut up. And so the court has the power and can do it. An officer of the court knows you cannot step outside the mandate of the court. But why do we keep talking about these institutions, Phil? Why is it important to talk about these institutions? And so how would they help even in the process of transition? And why was Norbert Mao talking about a dialogue? Because the question of transition is not a one-man affair. It is a national affair. And it's going to have to involve everybody. And institutions would be the only thing that weigh in, that provide guidance to that roadmap for transition. Roadmap for elections. We give a roadmap. We say there will be boundary delimitation. There will be opening of polling stations. There will be updating of a voter. That's a roadmap. So there should be a roadmap for a transition. This is what he's asking us to do at this point. And you asked me a categorical question, are there legal means in which therefore we can handle this transition? And I'm saying, yes, they are there. One of the legal means is have a proper constitutional review process that will involve all Ugandans. The other legal method that you could use in this transition and in the question of transition is the question of reforms. Can those reforms be representative? Not the Attorney General saying, we are now ready to bring reforms on the floor of Parliament. Where are they coming from? Power belongs to the people in Article 1 of the Constitution. Have you talked to the people? What are the people saying? You banned Bimenza. So when we talk about these institutions, where were the citizens talking from? Citizens were talking in particular spaces. They used to go to football pitches and have conversation. They can't go there. Right now, you can't go to Kololo. How do you pass Kololo? Where? When? How can I say I'm calling my friends to have political conversation in Kololo? How? When the military is there.
Say garrison.
Who is going to allow you? You have to first apply to the military to access Kololo grounds. Those grounds used to be free for Ugandans. And so are many grounds across Uganda. They have been captured. They've been taken by my friend Pollar Awich. But I am saying that the only way to allow Ugandans to interact with what it is that is going to affect them is give them space to talk. They must talk on radio stations. Chimenza must come back. Allow them to talk in Chimenza. Allow them to have a consultative process. Allow the institutions to come back and function.
every time there's anything going to happen in Parliament, Parliament has to seek permission as to whether they are going to pass a certain bill, a certain way, as long as it is political, it has any political inclination or tension or whatever, it must first undergo approval and an approval system. But is that how a free parliament should work? Is that what Article 79 was meant to do? The judiciary. Right now, there are certain decisions which just can't come out of the judiciary. And every time a decision comes out of the judiciary, which is celebrated, people say, where did it pass? But it actually passed within the same judicial system. I want to believe that there is hope. That the fact that we have that constitution in its manner, in its regions, and I keep saying this to Joseph, which he doesn't want to hear. I believe that there is hope. That the fact that we still have that constitution, saying a few things that it says, and the fact that we get some judgments recently, Zake Francis went to court and he said the speaker was violating his rights in parliament, and the judiciary agreed with him. This is a ruling that came to prove that there are certain rulings that will come out of court. The Constitutional Court on many times has come out to say, no, this is violation of a right, this is violation of a right. They've protected freedom of opinion, they've protected freedom of assembly. They've taken some time now, but they expunged Section 32 of the Police Act. They expunged Section 8 of POMA. In other words, they killed POMA entirely, and that came from court. So we can't say it is all gray. It is not. There is some levels of hope. Now, what we need to do is to think, if we must talk about transition, we must talk about the whole political framework. The framework in which we operate right now is growing more and more repressive to allow for that question of peaceful transition. The only way peaceful transitions happen, even in the places where they have happened, is when there has not been repression. And repression is caused by things such as economics. Look at the economics. People are poor. Poverty led Ugandans to war. When President Museveni went to war and he was in the bush, he used to tell Ugandans, you're poor. That Obote has kept you poor. Me, I will help you be rich. So once people continue to be poor, the question of poverty remains central and on the table. UBOS has statistics to that effect. People are poor. And economics determines a lot on the political question.
Thank you so much, Council. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your engagements. The Citizens Church goes into a very short break and we shall be right back.
Digital rights are those human rights and legal rights that allow individuals to access, use, create and publish digital media or to access and use computers, other electronic devices and telecommunication networks. Digital rights include a right to freedom of expression, information and communication through technology, a right to privacy and data protection, a right to credit for personal works, a right to universal and equal digital access, a right to identity, a right to anonymity, a right to be forgotten, and a right for protection of minors, among others. The state's digital rights are frequently violated through various unfair actions, for example, blockage of websites and social networks, theft of credentials, unauthorized use of people's data for personal gain, privacy intrusion, online censorship, arrests and intimidation of online users, internet blockages, and a proliferation of laws and regulations that undermine the potential of technology to drive social, economic, and political development worldwide. It is hence every citizen's responsibility to respect rights of other digital users and to speak out or report to the responsible parties when one's rights are violated.
You are still on Uganda's leading freedom platform, the Civic Space TV, and this is the Citizens Church. I am Phillip Muliisa. Today, we are talking transition, political transition in this country, and helping us in that discussion is retired Major Awich Pollar from the NRM, Honorable Ochieno Joseph from the Uganda People's Congress, and Council Charity Ahimbisibwe from Electoral Rules and Governance. Now, I want to begin this second segment by reading a quotation from the Minister of Justice and Constitutional Affairs, the Honorable Norbert Mao. He says, "The government of Uganda, where it is, including President Museveni, does not need to build another highway. He does not even need to build another bridge. He doesn't even need to commission another industrial park. All he needs to do is to preside over a peaceful transition of power." And I start with you, Honorable Ochieno Joseph. All he needs is to preside over a peaceful transfer of power. What are the likely scenarios in this transfer of power for this country called Uganda?
I honestly don't know what my good brother Norbert might have been thinking of. But roughly, I think, while we were out on break, conversations about this, including the definitions, were taking place. I think that this debate should really have been coined around the state of body polity in Uganda. I suspect the debate is taking place in the manner in which it is, one, possibly just to dupe Ugandans, but two, partly because Ugandans are feeling so helpless that they notice that after 40 years, it's almost impossibly likely that there will be an electoral process, in a free and fair electoral process in which one, either Mr. Museveni will not stand, or Museveni will stand, but it will be open, free, fair, competitive, that another leader comes into play. I think it's really the reason why people like the Nomad Mouse are talking. But also, in any case, I think people try to draw reference to the past history of our country and seeing how NRA is and how NRA is entrenched in itself, and particularly looking at some of the experiences, say, in the Libya, in the Sudan, and in Egypt. People are basically saying that, look, in our republic, it would be possibly unfortunate if we ended up with a change in which there is once again a military involvement. We've had military changes in this country, but this particular one, considering the foundations and the manner in which NRA is entrenched, there is quite clear suspicion that whatever happens, if it were violent, it would be one which would be close to possibly war of revenge, which, if you see what happened in Rwanda, could almost certainly be a possibly war of genocide, war of hate. But worse, because the sitting regime that is unwilling to let go is one that is sufficiently armed and armed to the teeth. They've militarized polity in this country. And the fact that Mr. Museveni is now very almost apparently preparing his son, and if he's not preparing his son, he's preparing other high-ranking military officials. I even hear from the grapevine that there may be possibilities that people like Kale Kayihura, this may be breaking news, may be making a return to the body politic of this country. So that really doesn't augur well. But what does it do? It confirms what I told you guys at the beginning, that we told you so. Museveni was what you called him, a gunman, in post-1980, and he became a gunman in Luweero. And since he came to power in 1985-86 with the DP and their friends, you know, he's used the military to sustain and keep himself. Now, because they've done that anyway, it clearly becomes apparent that, well, it's unlikely that he would let go voluntarily. As a matter of interest, in 1994-95, particularly about 1995, actually, leading to the NRA constitution of 1995 and leading to the post-elections, in fact, leading to the elections of 1995, monolithic election, which parties were still banned. The conversation inside UPC was whether or not we would allow members to participate, let alone us participate, because we couldn't participate because parties had been banned. And at the time, part of the contestation was between Cecilia Gwal, who was then leading our party here in Uganda, our then political ally, Sam Mugere, who had just left NRA, and whether or not we would form some political organization, which eventually we did, and Sam Mugere ended up participating in those elections. Well, what his position then was throughout that, look, you know, you guys, Museveni will not allow you win his election. You can't defeat him at his end game. And particularly because the whole thing has now been so much skewed in such a manner that political parties are still banned. You don't have the systems, you don't have the vehicles, the branches are still locked in. So you're absolutely disadvantaged. the fighter that you need to use is to focus on is mobilizing the majority of the citizens of Uganda, mobilizing Ugandans to say no and compel Museveni and compel his Western backers, who these days they call names, you know, to compel him to open up political space so that political parties can begin to freely, openly compete, you know, for political space, meaning return to multipartism. He was right at the time.
You keep talking about President Museveni and keeping power. What do you want him to do? To just let power go off his hand as a politician?
I think it's a fair question if Museveni had been elected. And the focus of my audience is that people exactly like you, who never saw Museveni come, and who have been duped to think that Museveni came as a Democrat, because he wasn't. Museveni was not elected into power. To expect, you're right, Museveni to basically walk out of State House, you're very right. My message, my focus is basically the more Ugandans demand, become aware rather that Museveni is not going to let them basically have it their way, the more likely we shall be having sufficient organization, and that's part of where I agree with the Charity, that really where we are at the moment. The most commonsensical things to do is to get a critical number of Ugandans who will make it impossible for Museveni's soldiers, you know, to shoot through them in Kololo, who make it impossible for Museveni's soldiers in the vast majority to ensure that polling stations, whether in Chinoni or in Nakaseke or somewhere in Dorwa, are not overrun by NRA, and that the majority of the people of Uganda seek to vote for and support candidates who are not Museveni or certainly not NRA, and therefore candidates who then turn up with the majority both in parliament and then in the presidency, candidates who then push us towards what you can call it a transition, and basically change, you know, certainly at the State House, and certainly changes in the composition in parliament.
Thank you so much, Honorable Channel. Major Witch, at the NRM Secretariat where you sit, do you have conversations of post-Museveni NRM, post-Museveni Uganda? How do they look like, and what are you looking at?
We do have. And to show you that we do have, we even discussed it in the passing of the party constitution. The party constitution envisages that a leader in the party comes and goes, and that at the moment is seven. So if we didn't have that kind of debate, we'd probably not have a constitution. Or if we had a constitution, we wouldn't have that provision which envisages that a leader will go and a leader will come and will go. So not only do we discuss, but we have institutional framework to guard against that. And this is the same thing with Uganda. So I was sitting here and asking myself, is it true that at the moment in Uganda, there's no provision for power moving from one president to another? Is there a lacuna in the law, in the constitution? Is there a gap? Did these people who sat in conference center in CA did not see that? All this brain, the Professor Kanyamba and the rest, there is no lacuna. Now, this is what I was saying, that maybe I wasn't clear enough. I am saying, even if you take the case of land dispute, let's say Meta, the Indian of sugar production, who has a big chunk of land, and there's issues about the land, but Meta is on that land, and the court has given a ruling that the status quo is in favor of the person on the land. So isn't it the person on the land who advocates for these other people around that, please, let us be peaceful so that when I leave peacefully? So in other words, the debate of peaceful transition is much in the interest of the incumbent than the nun. For example, there is a school of thought which thinks that institutions that make ruling goes on smoothly, like elections, like the courts which sit, for example, after a presidential campaign, You remember that Bobby Wine had filed a case and it withdrew, saying that he had no faith in the court. Okay? Dr. Besigye has been saying he has not faith in the election. So these are the people that, for us in NRM, we would even wish to teach them through patriotism that please abandon that way of not respecting the court. Abandon that way of not respecting election. Let us be peaceful so that we have peaceful transition. So the issue now, maybe you ask something.
Just briefly on that.
Mm.
You say it is in the interest of the person on the land.
Yes.
What happens in any case the court says he should leave and is not willing to leave?
It is clear. Once there's a court order, there's a process. In the case of a court, once there's a court order, there's proper means of implementing court order. That is why we have court brokers. That's why you take police to evict the person. But in the case of the state, where you vote, you have to win election. If you feel it is rigged, you go to court. If court rules that, in fact, you have rigged, get out. Unfortunately, we don't have yet a precedent. But I believe if court ruled like that, we would respect it. We would respect it. So you wouldn't even need a court broker to evict us. Because we would have, the court have ruled, please, if there's re-election, let's go back to the voters. If the court rules that this other one is the president, then be it. We would respect it. So the debate now should be where? Because the law provides that incapacity of a president. For example, now, if President Museveni incapacitated to be a president, are we really saying the entire Uganda, there's a lacuna in the law? There is. So there's no lacuna, which would now worry us about transition, both at national level and at... Now, what I see in the mind of Honorable Mao and others seem to be talking what they are not meaning, or they are meaning what they are not talking. I keep giving this example. My father had many daughters. Sometimes he would be calling Akelo when he means appeal. It's when he starts quarreling that appeal says, but daddy, you are calling Akelo. Because he will be now telling Akelo, you are not responding to what I'm saying. Say, but daddy, you are calling my sister. Then he says, sorry. So there are sometimes people talk what they mean while they don't mean what they're talking. In UN, when I was working in UN, we used to be clear in drafting. Are we drafting what we are meaning? So are these people really talking of a transfer of power from one person to another? Are they saying there's no law? Are they saying there's a lacuna? Or these people are actually saying, like you ask the congressman, they're actually saying we want Museveni to give us power.
What
so they seem to be talking what they are not meaning and meaning what they are not talking.
What they are saying is there is an avenue of elections, but it is vulgarized. The election elections are rigged. The court system is inefficient. That is what they are saying.
Then that is actually why I've interrogated and probed that they are talking what they don't mean and they're meaning what they're not talking. So let them reframe the debate. Let it be that debate. But if you cover up the debate under a transition, yet you are meaning something else, then the debate will be skewed up because we shall be debating a wrong thing. You have something else in your heart.
What do you think they mean?
They should frame what they're saying.
What do you think they mean?
What I thought they mean is that Museveni, give us power, walk away. That is what they're talking, a transition. That is actually what they mean. Museveni, you're in power, walk away, give us power, walk away. Which is really not correct. Otherwise, there's no lacuna in any transition system. The constitution provides in the incapacity of the president what happened. It is clear. And we have strong state machinery. We have the army, we have the police, we have the courts, we have everything. So why would one be worried about that? In our party, we have the constitution. In the incapacity of a chair, for us we call it a national chair, in the incapacity of a national chair, what happens? We have provision for that. So you can't tell me there's a lacuna. So these people, they're talking what they don't mean and they're meaning what they don't talk. They should better reframe the debate and put it squarely. But if the debate is Museveni, leave power, give it to us, then let us debate that. Is that correct? Under which provision of the law? Do you want him to walk away? Sure. Who told you? Who has sent you? How? Then we debate that. If what they're debating is we want Museveni to walk from power, give it to us, they shouldn't hide under a transition. What? No. Then I want to make comments about what Council said here. Maybe just a light on the law society. I think that some people went to court. I am an advocate myself, but I heard some colleagues went to court challenging a provision against the Attorney General, and a ruling was got. And I think that ruling is what Attorney General used to exercise this power from that ruling. And then Council mentioned something about party groups of members of parliament meeting before legislation. I should, indeed, NRM caucus meets. And I am a member of NRM caucus. Why? Because a movement caucus under our party constitution is an organ of the party. Just like you have Women League, you have Youth League, you have Disability League. So NRM caucus is a body under the party constitution. So as a director, I sit and attend the activities. So normally we call them for purposes of the fact that we presented a manifesto to the people during election. And all other operations now is actually implementing the manifesto we promised the people. So subsequent legislations, subsequent policies cannot arise from the manifesto. So we call our party members to say, please support this position. And it happens in all democracies, whether in America, whether in UK, there are party caucuses which tend to support a position they agree. So I don't think it is undemocratic. We do it, and we think we are doing it in good faith. And then the other comment about the Jake case. The case that Jake got is that she mentioned that these are some of the good things that come. It's not all that doom. I agree with you, Council. But all I want to add is that there are many good things out there. But when good things come, people argue that it is supposed to come anyway. But when bad ones come, it is a failure of NRM. I've often given this example. If Batoro and Banyoro are living peacefully, it is them who should live peacefully anyway. If Acholis are fighting the Madi in a power land, you see, it is a failure of NRM. NRM has failed to make people live together. So how do you choose the Banyoro living peacefully with Batoro to be a natural vent and the Acholi fighting the Madi to be a failure? So Council, I agree with you, but there are so many. And unfortunately, bad news travels faster than good news. And I've always repeatedly said, no news is good news. So when a whole week goes with no news, actually that is a week when there are good things about NRM. The week that you see something shooting up, it is the week when there was one mistake. So I am okay because no news is good news, because bad news travels faster than good news. So the Zake case, the cancellation of the Palmer, and all these other things, there are very many things. Very many things every day movement is doing and government, and in line with our manifesto. Only that good things don't shine, but they only wait for the negative. So if a whole week goes, it's okay for me. No news is good news. So Zake case is just one. I think that is what.
Thank you, Major. I want to engage Councillor Ahimbisibwe here. A couple of things emerge in the political environment of this country, and one of the major and recent ones is the Patriotic League of Uganda, which of course rebranded from the MK movement. What do such emergencies say to your mind as a lawyer and an activist of good governance in this country?
So the Patriotic League, first and foremost, came on as an organization because it was registered under URSB. URSB registers companies. Companies can be limited by guarantee or by shares. They can be public or private. And his falls in the category of a private company. A political party, on the other hand, should have come under the Political Party and Organizations Act. It should not have come through URSB. So there is still a conflict on what is PLU. Is it a political party? Is it going to metaphorize into a political party? Is it an organization? And what is the organization meant to do? If it is a private organization, we need to now go and look at their memorandum and articles of association, because those must be published on your SB website. It is just modus operandi. The normal norms that when a company registers itself, the memorandum and articles are put up by URSB. So anybody should be able to access the memorandum and articles of association of that organization.
Maybe briefly, before you continue, when you say it's a company, the company law in this country, which I do not understand so much, do we have companies whose role is to teach patriotism?
No. You see, companies are governed by the Companies Act. And the Companies Act is clear. For you, if you have an organization which you want to start up, electoral laws, what is it going to do? And in whose interest is it? Who are the beneficiaries? So for him, he has said patriotism. What is it going to do? And that's why I'm saying now, to understand that what is it going to do are the objects or the memats, the objects of that company. The memorandum and articles of association is what we need to look at. So companies law requires that when you establish a company, that company should be clear in objective. Who is it going to serve? Who are the beneficiaries? And why is it being established? That is totally different. The Companies Act is totally different from the Political Parties and Organizations Act. And the reason why the two are distinct is because a company has requirements that the law places on it, including the fact that now, as a company, a veil can be lifted. Lifting of the veil in company law is we lift it to know who are the people behind it, who has the power, who runs it, and what is the reason. Are they evading taxes? Do they pay taxes? When you set up a company, it must pay taxes. URA file returns annually. Those are part of the requirements for a company.
So the PL is paying taxes, PLU?
Those are the things that we should be asking, because it registered under URSB, it should pay taxes. It should. Under all circumstances, it should file returns. It should, because that is what the law requires. Once you're registered as a company, that is what you're supposed to do. If you're a political party, it is different. Those are ideas. It is for association. It is for opinion. It is for exchange of... It's totally different. It's now governed by the Political Parties and Organizations Act. So if you want to ask me about PLU, right now, I don't know. It is still in its formation. I find it difficult to make an objective comment about a company that seems to have ideas of a political party. Two things are being confused at this stage. Is it, for me, what I prefer from a legal point of view is be clear. Are you a company? If you're a company, are you living up to the standards that are required by the Companies Act? If you are a political party, or if you were a company going to metamorphosize into a political party, what are the requirements and how is it going to happen? And until it becomes a political party, I will not make a political comment about it.
But
does it therefore mean for our political organizing? You see, when these people talk about transition, we saw Namibia. It is Namibia, not Botswana. I kept saying Botswana. Namibia, Dr. Haig died. And when he died, the vice president took over. And when he took over, nothing happened in that country. There was no war. There was no confusion. They read the constitution. What does the constitution say when the president dies? And he was even being treated from inside his country. He did not go to US, UK, or wherever. Inside his own country, he was being treated, and he died. And there was a peaceful transfer of power to the vice president, who was also said, I am organizing for elections to happen. So when they see things like those, and you know when they kept saying, and power has been passed on, you know, it was happening so fast on social media that anybody thought this was a lie, you know? You imagine DRC Congo now, if Tshisekedi died, Would there just be that power has been transferred peacefully to the vice president in DRC Congo, even the way in which it is right now? And it's the same thing now, Uganda. The question that the people who propagate transition are saying, they're saying, what if the president is no more? What happens? How do we transition? The constitution has provisions, like my friend Paula Awich has said, and that is very true. But would we follow those constitutional provisions at that point? Would Uganda be able to say, as a country, now this is what the constitution provides, that the vice president takes over as we arrange elections? Can that happen in Uganda? That's the question people are putting on the table. And they are saying it might not happen. And because they think it might not happen, they begin to talk about a transition. But to talk about a transition, now, because for me, I like being objective, I like us to look at it from two sides, can also be a dream in Uganda. We have had a scenario of where we've had military men governing Uganda. We've also had a scenario of where we've had civilians governing Uganda. But the civilians only govern Uganda for months. Binaisa left when he was crying, oh, Entebbe woman. Why? Because he was not a military man. Lule, it was Lutwa, 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 Lutwa. And then what happened? There was an Amin who ruled, and actually him, he ruled almost longest. He had 9 years because he had a gun. Everything was happening with a gun. And right now we have President Museveni, who once in a while reminds us, I went to the bush. He does. He says, I went to the bush. It's not once, not twice. When you annoy him, he forgets about the constitution and he comes and says, I went to the bush and this is why I went to the bush.
Are you trying to say that to rule Uganda, one needs a gun?
Yes, as it looks, as of now, you must be a military man to rule Uganda.
Thank you so much. Honorable Chen.
Do you mind just to help trigger our young viewers? Briefly. That this Muhozi thing, very difficult to name it, that they call a pressure group. They call it a pressure group. Kumbe, it's a company.
It was registered at URSB.
So what's the difference between that and an average civil society organization, which is possibly, what would not be the difference?
I think
wanted to ask you.
Paula will now help us understand that, because ideally...
I was basically telling you from a legalistic point of view. I'm not putting you on the spot.
I wanted to ask you about this company.
Thank you for not answering my question.
No, it is a good question. It is an absolutely very beautiful question that you put across, Joseph, because civil society organizations, the ones that are registered at URSB, also have requirements on them that are mandated by law, the Companies Act, which is run by URSB. And some of them that are registered by the NGO Act, under the NGO Bureau, also must follow the act as it is. So you must be clear, what are you? Are you a company? Are you a civil society? Are you an organization? What are you? The law always requires, who are you?
Oh, are you a project?
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you. Yeah. Honorable Ochieno, this company you talk about the company, legally speaking, that has regional vice chairpersons. Its chairperson is, of course, Muhoozi Kainerugaba. Then regional central,
Muhoozi,
east, west.
Museveni's son, the general.
Yes.
The serving military general.
Yes, that
okay.
one.
All right.
Regional vice chairpersons, Buganda, Western Uganda, North, everywhere, carries out weekly or monthly barazas. This week they're in Masaka, the other week they were in Bushenyi. They are moving around the country. From the UPC perspective, what is your view of this company? Is it going to give this country enough tax?
It's a project. It's a project. To be blunt, this is Museveni and his family working around Ugandans and working the heads of Ugandans for 40 years. And amazingly, Ugandans are just clapping. Number two, Museveni and his family working up Ugandans, and amazingly, particularly young Ugandans like you, just clapping. And amazingly, Museveni and his son and his family working up Ugandans, and most shockingly, competent, decent, well-educated, average, little young Ugandans like my beautiful sister here, if they're not clapping, they're not offering themselves for leadership to transit Uganda from Musevenism to something that is slightly better than what UPC did, because UPC set the mark so high that I know it's difficult to outdo it, but at least to go somewhere close to UPC. And somebody like a Comrade Awich, but because he's serving under NRM Secretary, I don't want to put him on the spot, but there are Ugandans who are of Comrade Awich's background, status, and academia and everything else. And in Comrade Awich's case, he even knows how to clean the gun, you know, the point that Chatteris talk about. And there are many Ugandans who are like Comrade Awich, and they're clapping for Mr. Museveni's son after 40 years. This is no monarchy. Oh, by the way, our panelist, Dr. Ojambo, of course, you know, had to leave for a very particular reason, for which we give him all the solidarity, and we miss him. But at the introduction, when he was telling us about the history of this country and the foundations around many of these other things, we look through that, and then you see, from the founding principles and founding values, and from the founding commitments from Lancaster to founding principles around the 1962 as we went for independence, whatever all the contradictions, surely our founding parents never ever envisaged Uganda in which would be having a political monarchy, in fact a military monarchy as such. So really it must be done with Mr. Museveni and his son, for heaven's sake. So the insulting thing about it really is this, that this organization now runs, is it a company? And now, of course, you know, I'm not a lawyer, and now I understand they've got to do some filings, and I hope they're watching. And now I've been asking and wondering whether or not they're a civil society, charitable organizations or not. But then I was on another program the other day, including with a serving minister of NRA, who happens to be a member of this charitable, allegedly, or civil activist organization. And part of the objects of there, he's joining this thing, he's saying that, no, we're just a mini pressure group. And the mini pressure group, one of his clear objects apparently is to criticize NRA and say how bad NRA is in handling corruption. And that for them, they're going to deal with corruption. So I wonder, our charity, this pressure group is saying that one of the things they will do as a pressure group for the Republic of Uganda is to deal with the things that NRA failed to do and their NRA. Things that NRA failed to do, and the NRA ministers, what mandates them. But like I said again at the beginning, apparently at the other meeting the other day, Phil, local government leaders came from across the country in that meeting, and I've been asking, and I think I asked at the beginning of this program, and Charity Pat laid the other element of it, is this. Who is funding this organization? Who is giving them the clearances? Three, who cleared the local government officials to leave their respective stations to come to Kampala, and on what terms and on whose terms? Were they doing like a Janani Luhumi walk to Kampala, for which is statutory, or were they doing something massively political? No, this is a facade. It's a Museveni project, whatever it is, and Ugandans need to wake up and begin to simply say no. Not to Museveni playing around with their future. Yes, to a free offer from our point of view to continue preaching for peaceful transition, but it cannot be a monarchical a transitional process. I think what is really, really sad is for Ugandans to allow somebody who loses elections, goes to Luweru, Bushes, commits havoc in this country, takes power, and rules for 40 years, breaks our economy, breaks our health services, breaks our educational systems, breaks our infrastructure, kills our aeroplanes, kills our railways, kills our roads, kills our environments, kills our Mabira, kills our Mabira forests, you know, kills our infrastructure in Kampala, and then has the audacity to come and initially say his son will repair the potholes in Kampala using, you know, this charity thing, repair the potholes in Kampala. And I told this program that I didn't know where he was going, how he was going to repair it, maybe using cow dung.
Thank you, now, after that, Ochieno.
It's a charitable organization as a czar, you know, to knock off corruption. No, Ugandans, wake up, you're being taken for a ride by Mr. Museveni.
Talk to us, the Patriotic League of Uganda. What is it in your view as the NRM, and how are you relating to it?
Patriotic League really has no legal binding with NRM. I think the only link there is that many participants, many, and I use the word many intentionally, because there are other people from NUP, I think members of parliament from NUP, and other members of parliament from other political parties. But the only link is that the majority are people who are NRM party card holders. And of course, the other link is that the chairman is the son of our president, the son of our national chairman. So there are those open linkages, unless there's an unseen link. But to me, as the person at the secretariat, that is the only link. Now,
does it worry you that a person so close, like a son of a president, is saying there is something wrong with the NRM?
It doesn't worry me, because NRM encourages freedom of speech and open criticism. Actually, I can assure you, if you went to a meeting like NEC of NRM, you'd think you're in a meeting of rebels against NRM, because people criticize so much, especially areas like areas of corruption and all that. Even in NRM, we discuss it. So, although we normally advise that those criticisms should be in the right forum, but it's not strange to us that a group of NRM makes criticism. Even me here, I can make criticisms. It's okay. So we're not worried about it. But we hope that when they meet us, that association, even if it is not an organ of the party, like I told you, I have several organs, the youth, the women, the disability, the entrepreneurs, the members of parliament, who have those leagues. But this is not part of the league. But we do hope that their criticisms are criticisms in good faith. And even if they present it to us in our forum, we shall discuss it. For example, if they are concerned about corruption, it's okay. But for now, we are not worried. For us, we think that NRM has institutions, and when it comes to decision-making, we shall make it at the right time about choosing our flag bearer. Yesterday, there was a group of NRM, and I was called there, because they had called the Secretary General, and the Secretary General was busy, and we were called that there was a group of NRM members who had actually sat in Katikati to make a petition to SEC. So I was called to receive their petition on behalf of the Secretary General, to take it to Secretary General, or even to take it to Haji Kigongo. So their resolution was to the effect that they're urging the chairman to be cognizant of an earlier SEC decision in Chobe Lodge, in the national park, what we used to call Kabalega National Park or Maxon, depending on how you choose to call it. But there was a resolution by SEC to the effect that Museveni is a flag bearer in 2016 and beyond. And SEC is the only organ that can reverse its own decision. It's like a decision by Supreme Court. The Supreme Court can be the only person who can set its precedent and overturn it. So for now, as the party stands, that resolution stands. And yesterday's a section of party members is to the effect that, please, Mr. Chairman, we call on you to observe this resolution. And in effect, they're actually asking the president to stand again. So meaning that, therefore, as a party, we have organism. It's a lively party. It's not hard and frozen. Many voices will be coming up. And for us from the secretariat, we are like the judge. We wait for all of them, and we process them and put them in the right forum. For example, if we are to process the candidates who have shown interest, we'd process them and table them in the national conference that, as a secretariat, these are the aspirers we have got, and this is the other one. So,
thank you, Major. As we conclude, our time is really spent fast. Councillor Ahimbisibwe, he says there is a Chobe resolution that President Museveni should be the flag bearer 2016 and beyond. Do you see President Museveni standing in 2026? And how does he end?
Yes, for me, it has always been clear that as long as President Museveni is alive, will be on the ballot paper. I've never missed my words about that. I've said it
even when the son said he would be the one to be on the ballot paper in 2026, I said I could almost bet that the president would be on that ballot if he's alive. Why? Because of what he has just told you. One, the NRM agreed that he would be their candidate. Number two, he has not given any indication whatsoever that he would not be president. Everything he does shows you that he's still commander-in-chief. Everything he does shows you he's still president of the Republic of Uganda. Because if he was not interested in being president, he would have given signals. There are signals that are clear in the political and governance spectrum for anybody to begin to see that this person is actually saying he's not going to be president. So it's not going to be shocking that the president will be on the ballot in 2026. We have an office of the national chairman, which is funded directly by himself and is run by a lady called Hajat Namialo.
Yes.
And it sits in Kyambogo. And it goes around mobilizing young people. They give out sewing machines. They give out different incentives. They give out hair making machines. They help people with farming. They moved to the kingdom of Busoga recently. She was there. They went to Mbale to the Bamasaba. They've been to Mbara. There have been different spaces, and they are in the office of the national chairman, which is situated in Kyambogo. They wouldn't be doing that, and there is a slogan, Muzei Tova Kumein. That slogan, everybody knows it. It is existent. If the president was not going to come back, why would that slogan be there? Why would this office of the national chairman be fully operational? And what is its role? Why is it going around the country and doing the work that it is doing, and all this publicity is happening? So the president will be on that ballot in 2026. And he will be elected again as president of Uganda.
So you are declaring the result.
He will pass. He'll pass as president of the Republic. But as a matter of interest, I know you are going to ask me. Charity raised a very important question about this office of the national chairman, allegedly. You know, I didn't know about the existence of this NRA office until the other day. I was in some television program where somebody from that office, apparently, was hosted on the same program. And he was protesting this charity thing of Mr. Muhoozi. And apparently the guy was arrested and spent several days behind bars. And the day when I was hosted was the day when the message was going around that he had been released on the intervention of this lady chairperson or the head of that office. That's
yes,
very strange, isn't it?
So
if you don't mind. So I wonder, who funds that office? Is it a public office?
That was my question to Major Witch. Yeah. Is it the NRM that funds the office of the national chairman?
Yes, it is. You know, under the party constitution, we have office of the chair. And it is Article 14H. Article 14H provides that the chairman shall do everything necessary to promote the principles of the party. Meaning that if he so deems that he should appoint that lady to mobilize the people, so be it. So that Article 14H gives the chairman a lot of discretion to do things that ideally would not have been foreseen. Mobilization for patriotism, mobilization for this and every other thing.
Where so does it that is leave lawful. The publicity office of the party?
The publicity office of the party is mainly to give out information. For example, basically it starts from when an organ sits and passes a resolution. It is it to bring out, we have said this is a resolution. Or many day-to-day information that accumulates in the party, he sends it out for people to know. So basically, that is the information directorate. But the office of the chair under Article 14H, office of the national chairman, in 14H, it gives him discretion to do whatever he deems. So the chair can use that provision to do whatever he wants. And it is proper for the party. He can even ask the party money to be given to him for that activity. It is provided for in Article 14H.
Thank you. Honorable Chair. Mm-hmm. Is President Museveni standing in 2026? And Are you ready to stand against him?
Has he ever stood down since he came in 1986? So he's been a continuous ruler. You know, so it's a process. I'm just genuinely concerned about whether or not he was strategically going to let for his son through the charity which has been set. I don't know if it's a charity or not. But as I said, until this television show last week, when it became apparent that somebody from his office, you know, went to the media to protest the Muhoozi thing, and he was arrested or disappeared. And so the argument was that if that's happened, then Museveni must be sanctioning whatever the Muhoozi group are doing in their new organization, which I'm finding very difficult to pronounce. And I'm deliberately not very particularly interested in pronouncing it until it becomes an apparent political party. You know, so on the basis of what Comrade Awich has said, I have no reason not to believe, though, that Mr. Museveni is around until, you know, the time when Jesus advises us as citizens of Uganda, what next for us as a country. But I am still also very concerned that seeing how his son is behaving with this charity, was that it a business Jesus thing? You know, us. It must be that it's a game between Museveni and members of his family. That said, you ask about UPC. No, of course, if only Museveni's offices were efficient, and if only he was able to fund the other elements of the government independently, like the judiciary and others. My matter, which was a judicial review, we should have taken 6 months, will be 3 years next month. So in the event that that is resolved, of course, then I will be the president of Uganda People's Congress. And of course, as president of Uganda People's Congress, I would almost certainly be the presidential candidate for Uganda People's Congress come the next election, whether it's election charade or whatever the case, shall cross the bridge when that happens. And should that happen anyway, my job will be to focus, one, on pushing Uganda People's Congress and this candidature, but genuinely engaging the rest of the other democratic opposition to investigate some of the issues that we've been trying to talk about, because I'm not quite sure this space is sufficient for it.
Thank you so much.
I would be very happy to be his running mate. You know,
amen.
Represent some of his views.
Amen. 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 We are the future. Give me mine. Beautiful.
Major Awich, I don't know if the NRM is ready for this deal, but I wanted to ask one of the most decorated generals of this country, General Muhoozi Kainerugaba, is by look of things involved in the politics. Does the NRM look at presenting him as a candidate in 2026?
I think being a serving army officer, somebody should have mentioned the coinage, the formation of this organization that he heads was actually to cure that part that is a serving officer and it should not be political.
Church.
And this is why this organization is non-political. So that he is not...
Otherwise, it's officially really political.
So that he's not seen to be acting political. But with this kind of organization, which is non-political, it can preach patriotism, for example.
Like a company?
Actually, what I wasn't sure about its company status, but I think the law now requires, even if you are registering an NGO, you register also with URSB.
Yes, but URSB is governed by the Companies Act, Council.
So you can register actually an NGO, but you must also register it with the Register of Company under Companies Act. So, but this is an organization which was meant to make that if you are an army officer and you want to involve in activities in society, it must not be political. I think that was to address it. But your question is specific about fielding him as NRM. NRM has a constitution on who becomes a flag bearer. You must be elected by a national conference in Nambole. And of course, before that, you meet the legal standards like the constitution provides. For example, you must have resigned from your work, okay? You must have the basic education qualification, I think it is senior 6, okay? You must be above 18. So we meet, whoever will want to come with us meets all the legal requirements for the state and that one. So, but for, so.
Major, in the interest of time, just one last one. Is Jeno Muhoozi a member of the NRM party?
No, Jeno Muhoozi, as a serving army officer, like all serving army officers, they don't hold party cards.
They Thank don't you.
Hold party cards, and they are not in the registry of the party.
Thank you so much, Major Awich, for that submission, and thank you so much for joining us today. Honorable Ochieno Joseph, thank you so much for being with us.
Always a pleasure and delighted to be with these colleagues.
And Council Ahimbisibwe Charity, thank you so much for being here with us today. And
thank you, Phil.
You, our viewers, thank you so much for keeping with us all this time. It is the Citizens Church on Civic Space TV. Remember, this is made possible by the Center for Constitutional Governance, and we appreciate the work done by that particular organization. Special thanks to the people behind the machines, Pearl, Malcolm, and the other people behind the machines. From us, we say a good evening, and may you have freedom always.